We will start with section 5.1.2, which is the exchange forces. We will study their nature, and this has something to do with the bonding in a molecule. And we will come to know at the end that actually it is not a force, but it behaves like a force. It seems that there is a force. It seems that there is a force of attraction, and it seems there is a force of repulsion between different kind of particles. Like there is attraction between the bosons, and there is attraction between the repulsion between the fermions. And the attraction or repulsion seems to be as a result of an exchange force, but in reality there is no force. So we will see the fact behind this thing, that what kind of exchange force this is. So let's start with a geometry, that we are having two particles, particle 1 and particle 2, and they are in the state psi x1 and psi bx, means the function of this x, right? Particle 1 and 2, when the particles will be distinguishable, then we can say that particle 1 is in state A and particle 2 is in state B. Or we can say that particle 1 is in state B and particle 2 is in state A. But when the particles will be identical, then we cannot say which particle is in which state. We can only say that one particle is in one state and the other particle is in the other state. We don't know about the identity of the particle because both are identical. If I consider only this state as a single state and this is a single state, then they are different states. They are non-overlapping states. And when I consider their linear combination, like I consider addition in between them, or subtraction is also a form of addition. In that situation, the states will be overlapping. And that overlapping is actually causing the effect which we call as exchange force. The attraction and the repulsion are the result of the symmetrization. Means the symmetry is playing the role that these two particles seem somehow to attract each other or repel each other. So it is caused by the overlapping of wave functions, and then the symmetry means when the wave functions will overlap, then they will be either symmetric or anti-symmetric. And this will give us the reality behind the forces, that what kind of exchange force is this one. So let's start that we consider between them, we will consider three cases here. Three cases will be for the distinguishable particles, for the identical particles. In identical particle, we will discuss the bosons and the fermions. And these states are actually the position wave functions. And in addition to the position wave functions, we call them spatial wave function because they are the space dependent. And then there is an additional thing that we studied, which was the spin of a particle. Now the spin of a particle is not spatial. It is not space dependent. It is described by the spinners. So if I want to discuss the complete state of a particle, it will have its space-dependent wave function means the function which is depending on space, and it will be combined with the spinner. Spinners are actually behaving like vectors, and they are describing the spin of a particle. So let's first we will describe the whole story with the spatial wave functions, and then at the end we will combine spin with it. Okay, so we are starting with this one. We discuss some properties of these states. If I do integration on all space, when I don't write the limit, it means it is on the whole space, so it is understood. And psi a, a function of x, and if I take a conjugate, and then psi a function of x, this thing I can write is like this as well, psi a, and this is equal to 1. So it means psi a is a normalized wave function. Similarly, I can write that psi b with psi b is also equal to 1, while psi a with psi b and psi b with psi a is equal to 0. Their inner product is equal to 0. It means that these are orthogonal functions as well. So combinedly, I can write them in the form of Dirac delta, in the form of Kronecker delta, in which I write delta m and f. M will be equal to m, means these indices are the same, we will get 1, and if these indices will not be the same, we will get 0. So these are the conditions for the orthonormal wave functions. This I can say that these functions are orthonormal. Orthonormal wave functions. And we will go on with these wave functions. Now, I'm having two coordinates. One is x1 and the other is x2. X1 and x2 are my coordinates. What will be the difference between them? I can write this x1 minus x2. This will be the difference between the two. Now, as I am considering overlapping wave functions, then I will consider the expectation value of this. This is the difference between the two coordinates, the two spatial variables. Okay, and this will be equal to, if I take the square of this, x1 minus x2 whole square, the expectation value squared, then this is equal to, if I take x1 whole square, expectation value, plus x2 whole square, expectation value, minus 2 times x1 and x2 expectation value. And we will now consider different cases in them. And the first case is of distinguishable particles. When the particles can be distinguished, then what will be the situation? You know about the distinguishable particles, that if I write their combined wave function psi x1 and x2, then this is equal to psi a x1 and psi b x2. This is their combination, their composite wave function can be written like this. For the distinguishable particles, we have discussed this in the previous lecture. Now, what about x1 square? What about x1 squared means the expectation value squared? What will be this equal to? Let me write the square of the expectation value of x1. So this will be equal to any expectation value, you know, you can write like this, that integral, and this is, let's say, the expectation value of x. This is equal to sine conjugate x and sine, and then dx, the variable on which you are finding this thing out. So this I can write like this as well, sine x sine. In the bracket quotation, I can write it like this. Now what about this one? I will write this in the integral form, and in the integral form it will be this sine conjugate and then x1 squared and then this sine and dx. Clear? So what it will be? I will now write this sine in terms of the composite wave function. So I can write that sine A conjugate and a function of x1, then sine B conjugate, a function of x2, then x1 squared, then sine A and sine B, x2. And what the dx will become? Now it is no more dx but two variables, dx1 and dx2. Dx1, dx2. Clear? And now further I can write this, means I will write the integral. And this thing is equal. Look here. I can combine sine x1 conjugate with sine ax1 and x square and dx1. So I can write this, there is no harm in writing it like this, that sine a conjugate x1 and x1 squared d, sine a x1 dx1, and then I write separate integral for the other one, which is sine b x2 and sine b x2 dx2. Clear? Dx1 coming here, dx2 coming here, and x1 is, this is the dependent coordinate. I am finding out x1 square, expectation value. So it has nothing to do with psi b because that's x2 function. When I will write x2 square, then I will write x2 here. And this will have nothing to do with the x2. So what about this relation? If you look at it, these are orthonormal functions. And orthonormal functions are psi b will give you 1. So this goes to 1. And I will have, I am left only with this one. Now how can I write this one? This x1 squared is actually the, when I am left only with this one, x1 is the coordinate, means the special variable, x1 is the expectation value, and x1 is the integration of this one. So it means odds are x1. So I can write psi a of x, means it's a function of the same variable, x here, and then psi x here, and dx here. So x1 I can consider like x, means it is now overall the same variable. So I can write that this is the single state expectation value of x square, and this I write is x square, and I write a with it. where A denote that this is only state A. Clear? Similarly, I can write the x2 square expectation value. What I am going to do, I am finding out, first I found this one, now I am finding out this one, and then I will find out these two, so I will be able to write this thing as a whole. So I am finding them in components form, and then we will come to this relation. Clear? And we will be able to find out the difference of the spatial coordinates and its square expectation value. Clear? What will be this one? X2 square. I am not writing, but I will just say like this. I will write like this, then I will come here and it will be like this. Here it will be x2, and then rest of the equation. Then I will come here and psi A conjugate will be multiplied with this one, because x2 will have nothing to do with this one, and here I will write x2. So this one, this term means the psi A terms will become 1, just like the psi B term here. And this one I will now, x2 will be here. So this is x2, and I can write this one is the square expectation value of a single state, which is B state. Clear? This thing is clear? And now I am in a position to write this thing. So if I consider the single state, then this is the x1 square.